Well, good morning and welcome to everyone. For those that I've not yet had the chance to meet, my name is John Highbush. I have the honor of being the Executive Director of the Ronald Reagan Presidential Foundation. And on behalf of Mrs. Reagan and the Board of Trustees of the Reagan Foundation, I want to thank all of you for being here today. I'd like to begin by recognizing some special guests that we have in the audience. And I'd like to start with former Senator and absolutely terrific former Governor of the state of California, as well as a Reagan Foundation Board of Trustee, Pete Wilson. Pete. And if you would please stand, we are honored to have ambassadors, consul generals, and deputy consul generals from Hungary, the Czech Republic, Poland, Bulgaria, Romania, Germany, Ireland, Lithuania, and Great Britain. I think you all are here in the front row. Of course, we'd like to welcome back our former California Congressman, Elton Gallagher. Elton. Former Congressman Ernie Conniu, a Hungarian immigrant to the U.S. after World War II. Ventura County Supervisor Peter Forey. Peter. Chief of Protocol for the County of Los Angeles, Lourdes Saab. Los Angeles 5th Supervisory District Commissioner, Dr. Frank DeBello. Just a few more, Mr. David Simon, President of the Southern California Committee for the Olympic Games. Finally, Dr. Justinian John Paul, Founder, Executive Director of the Wendy Museum, whom we have worked with to display a unique Cold War artifacts here at the Reagan Library and Museum. We also have with us today a number of other current and former diplomats, distinguished professors, scientists, bankers, lawyers, actors, producers, community and religious leaders who are either experts on or originate from a number of Eastern European countries. Thank you all for joining us today. Well, although we are a few weeks shy of the actual anniversary, we're gathered here today to commemorate the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall and the advent of freedom and democracy in Central and Eastern Europe. Today, countless people around the world enjoy greater freedom, more economic prosperity, and better lives as a result of President Reagan's leadership. And it is that leadership that we will celebrate today. In conjunction with the Consul Generals of the Czech Republic, Hungary, and the Republic of Poland, we have brought together a fascinating panel of experts who will offer a little of their insight into how the world has changed in the last 25 years. We're privileged today to have as our moderator, Mr. John O'Sullivan, who has traveled here from Budapest. He was with us back in 2009 when we celebrated the 20th anniversary of the fall of the wall, and we were privileged to have him as a keynote speaker in Krakow, Poland, during President Reagan's centennial year in 2011. There, we commemorated the special relationship that he had with then Pope and now Saint John Paul II. John O'Sullivan is a director of the Danube Institute in Budapest. He is by nature a prolific writer and has been with Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty, for many years. John was a special advisor to Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher in Downing Street and later he was one of the team that worked with Lady Thatcher on her memoirs. He is the author of one of the best-known books of the story behind the ending of the Cold War, entitled The President, the Pope, and the Prime Minister, Three Who Changed the World. We also have with us three extraordinary individuals serving on our panel this morning. The first is the Honorable Petra Gondalovic, Ambassador of the Czech Republic in Washington, D.C., having assumed this post in May of 2011. Ambassador Gondalovic was elected to the Federal Assembly of the Czech and Slovak Federal Republic in 1990. Since that first role in the democratically elected body, he has served in numerous positions throughout the Czech government. From 1997 to 2002, he was appointed Consul General of the Czech Republic in New York. And prior to this current posting, he was the Director General of the Economic and Information Section at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Our second panelist is the Honorable Ferenc Kumin, Consul General of Hungary in New York. He has served as a political media analyst, a popular lecturer at some of the top schools in Budapest, and in 2006, he became head of the Department of the Office of the President of the Republic, responsible for the communication and strategic planning for the former President of Hungary. In 2012, he was asked to serve as a Deputy Secretary for International Communications in the Office of the Prime Minister before moving to his post in New York. And our final panelist today is Adam Michnik. Mr. Michnik is editor-in-chief of Poland's most important nationwide daily newspaper, which began publishing in 1989 as the first legal newspaper of the Solidarity Trade Union. He is a prolific author and one of Poland's most prominent former dissidents, having been sent to prison several times for his political convictions, starting at the age of 19. He wrote for underground newspapers and supported the Independent Solidarity Trade Union. Although free at the time, when the communists imposed martial law in 1981, Mr. Michnik was imprisoned again. In 1989, he took part in the roundtable talks as an advisor to Solidarity leader Lech Walesa and negotiated the first free elections in Poland. All these gentlemen have a lot in common in that they have firsthand knowledge of life behind the Iron Curtain. But lucky for us, I think they also hold different perspectives. I know we will hear today of some of those struggles, but I also hope we will hear that life is different, that it's better, and that the people of Eastern Europe are finally coming out from under the many years of communist repression and are willing, able, and excited to govern themselves, because that is what President Reagan had hoped for them. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Honorable Peter Gondalovic, the Honorable Ferenc Kumin, Mr. Adam Michnik, and our moderator, Mr. John O'Sullivan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, honored guests, and distinguished students. May I, on your behalf, thank the Ronald Reagan Library, John Hibosh and his colleagues for their great work, not only in organizing this event, but more generally for keeping the flame of scholarship alive on the Reagan presidency and the history of the Cold War. The Reagan presidency began in January 1981 and ended 8 years later. The Cold War ended, well, arguably on several occasions, but the 9th of November 1989, when the Berlin Wall was opened up and East Germans were allowed to cross freely into the West, is generally regarded as its the moment of its final curtain. These are now history, but they are very recent history for me and for my colleagues here on the panel. They are not history at all, but a vivid and dramatic turning point in our own lives, and of course in the lives of millions of people, including, let me talk to the students here, including your parents, who found themselves living in a world that was much freer and from which the threat of nuclear war had been lifted. If there was a single moment when everyone realized that the world had changed irrevocably, it was when we all saw the East Berliners streaming through the border crossings and making the wall irrelevant, a symbol of a broken past. Ronald Reagan left office 10 months before the Cold War ended. Why is he such a central figure in the celebration of its ending? The answer is that he pursued a series of policies that undermined the foundations of Soviet power, Soviet economic strength, and moral self-confidence. He summed up his own policies, I think, in the single phrase you just saw during a visit to Berlin in 87. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. 2 years later, the whole edifice, the empire as well as the wall, crumbled away, apparently, but not really, of its own accord. Now, that's not wisdom in retrospect. On the day that Ronald Reagan left office, the magazine I then edited published a front-page cover story entitled The Coming Crack-Up of Communism by a young Polish writer, our chief foreign correspondent, Radek Sikorski. Communism duly cracked up 10 months later. The author is today the president of the Polish parliament. Sometimes history reads like a novel. Of course, we can't, and I don't intend to give all the credit for this historical earthquake to one man. Among those with whom President Reagan must share the credit are Pope John Paul II, whose 1979 visit to Poland began the destabilization of Soviet power in Europe. My old boss and Reagan's great political partner, British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher. German Chancellor Helmut Kohl. Italy's defense minister, Francesco Cossiga, who was the first European statesman to install the US missiles that signified the strategic defeat of Moscow. Mikhail Gorbachev, who worked with Reagan to turn that defeat into a joint peace initiative. Anti-Soviet dissidents, such as Vladimir Bykovsky and Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who alerted the world to the continuing repression of millions under Soviet rule. Rebels who became leaders in Central and Eastern Europe, such as Vaclav Havel in Czechoslovakia, Joseph Antal in Hungary, Lech Wałęsa in Poland, and indeed Adam Michnik on today's panel. Nor should we forget President George H.W. Bush, whose skillful diplomacy ensured that the undermining of Soviet power, begun by Reagan and John Paul II, was carried through to a successful and peaceful conclusion. Now that last point is a crucial one. Empires, when they end, usually end in chaos and bloodshed. The end of the Soviet Empire was achieved without mass bloodshed. Not, alas, not without any bloodshed at all. People died in Georgia, in Lithuania, in Azerbaijan, after the Berlin Wall came down, but before the Soviet counter-coup had failed in 1991. But they did not die in millions or even thousands. The tanks were not sent in as they had been in Budapest in 1956, or when they were on one or two occasions sent in, they were quickly withdrawn. The final collapse of the Soviet Empire was a case of euthanasia rather than of direct murder. For that, we owe a substantial debt to Mikhail Gorbachev, but also to Ronald Reagan. His most famous epitaph was coined by Margaret Thatcher. Ronald Reagan, she said, won the Cold War without firing a shot. Usually, we notice the first half of that sentence. He won the Cold War. But the second half may be even more important. Without firing a shot. Now, that's not literally true. Shots were fired in the liberation of Grenada. But Ronald Reagan used military force or its threat very sparingly indeed. And on the rare occasions when he did use it, he offered the other fella the opportunity to settle their dispute by compromise and negotiation. Only when they refused did he authorize a military buildup or even the threat of force. There are other examples, but the most significant one of this is the handwritten letter he sent to Leonid Brezhnev in 1981 when he was recovering from the attempt on his life. He offered Brezhnev the chance to end the Cold War without even an expensive arms race. Since Russians and Americans, he said, had no good reason to be in conflict with each other. Alas, Reagan was rebuffed with a standard piece of Soviet agitprop. Later, Anatoly Dobrynin, the experienced Soviet ambassador in Washington, admitted that Moscow had miscalculated badly in not realizing the genuineness of Reagan's offer and the chance to end the Cold War on more equal terms. Now, many important events took place between that letter and the fall of the Berlin Wall. But Brezhnev's refusal led inexorably to the long Soviet defeat symbolized by the fall of the wall. Our distinguished panelists today saw that event from the other side of the wall. Any significance its collapse had for us was magnified many times for them. Let me therefore now turn to them and ask them in turn, beginning with Adam Michnik, who was directly involved in the politics of that day, ask them to cast their mind back to perhaps to 1977, before John Paul II, before Reagan's presidency, before the election of Margaret Thatcher, and ask him, when did he at that time see any possibility of a peaceful end to the communist empire in the middle 70s, and what he thinks eventually, what were the major forces bringing that the fall of the wall about? Adam Michnik.
Jakie są twoje wrażenia tego, co i w jaki sposób nastąpiło uzyskanie swobody i wolności przez kraje?
Wszystkim chciałem podziękować za zaproszenie na tę konferencję.
I'd like to thank for the invitation to this conference, to this meeting.
Przepraszam, że nie mówię po angielsku, ale tutaj się boję mówić nawet po francusku.
I apologize for not speaking English, but here I would be even afraid to speak French.
Ostatecznie mógłbym mówić po rosyjsku, ale w cieniu Ronalda Reagana to by może nie było stosowne. No.
Well, I could of course speak Russian, but I believe that in the shadow of Ronald Reagan that would not be very appropriate.
Ja myślę, że to co się stało w 1989 roku, to była zmiana na miarę rewolucji bolszewickiej. No.
It is my belief that the events of 89 are of the size of the importance of the Bolshevik Revolution.
Z tym, że jeżeli zwycięstwo bolszewizmu było katastrofą, to klęska komunizmu była wyzwoleniem.
Well, of course, there is a difference. The victory of Bolshevism was a catastrophe, but the defeat and demise of communism was freedom.
Liberation.
Well, actually liberation, yeah, more than freedom. I'm sorry. Looks that his English is not that bad.
Jak mnie pan pyta, co się zmieniło dla mnie, zmieniło się wszystko.
You asked me what changed for me. Well, for me, everything changed.
Jak wielu moich kolegów, ja byłem po prostu zwyczajnym kryminalistą przed 89 rokiem.
Well, as many as my friends and colleagues before 1989, I was just a criminal.
Ja pamiętam takie spotkanie w Pradze, taką konferencję międzynarodową, którą organizował prezydent Havel, a w której uczestniczyła pani Hillary Clinton.
I recall a conference in Prague organized or by invitation of President Havel in which participated Mrs. Clinton.
I prezydent Havel, którego się razu mnie złapał i słuchaj, przyjdź jutro o 17 do mnie do gabinetu na kawę i na koniak. Ja zaprosiłem Hillary i chciałem, żebyś ty ją poznał.
Well, President Havel grabbed me by the arm and said, look, come tomorrow evening to my cabinet and for coffee and brandy, I have invited Hillary Clinton.
No więc rzeczywiście ja przyszedłem i Hillary się mnie pyta, słuchaj Adam, mówi, wyście z Wacławem obydwaj byli kryminalistami, was trzymano w więzieniu. Jak ty się dzisiaj czujesz? Wacław jest prezydentem, ty jesteś szefem wielkiego dziennika.
Well, Hillary asked me, listen, Adam, you and Havel, you were just criminals before that. You were criminals. You were kept in prison, and today Havel is the president, and you are the editor-in-chief of the greatest, biggest newspaper in Poland. How do you feel?
Na co ja powiedziałem, wiesz, Hillary, to jest wszystko jak w złym amerykańskim filmie. No.
I told her, you know, Hillary, it all reminds me of a really, really bad American movie.
Dlatego, że na końcu jest happy end.
Because, as usual, at the end is a happy ending.
No więc to zmieniło się.
Well, this is what changed in my life.
I teraz ja patrzę oczywiście z polskiej perspektywy, która jest szczególna bardzo. Polska jest krajem wielkiego sukcesu. No.
From the Polish perspective, it is tremendously important because Poland is a country of a great economic success.
To jest sukces ekonomiczny, ale i polityczny, krótko mówiąc, cywilizacyjny.
Well, it's not only an economic success, it's also a political civilization success.
Przez ostatnie 400 lat Polska nie miała takich dobrych 25 lat jak teraz.
The last 400 years of Polish history weren't as good as the last 25.
No ale oczywiście przyszłość może być rozmaita. No.
Of course, the future is still ahead of us.
Dlatego, że to nie jest tak, jak myśmy myśleli, że po komunizmie mechanicznie następuje demokracja. Tak nie jest. No.
Well, it's because it's not exactly as we believed, as we thought, that right after communism, automatically, mechanically, democracy comes in.
Znakomity węgierski ekonomista Kornaj Janosz napisał niedawno esej, gdzie napisał, że te drogi po komunizmie mogą być rozmaite.
The great Hungarian economist Janosz Kornaj wrote lately in an essay that the roads after communism could go in different directions.
Jeżeli spojrzymy na Rosję, to zobaczymy, że komunizmu tam nie ma, ale jest dyktatura.
Well, let's take a look at Russia. There is no communism there, but dictatorship still exists.
To jest to, co Putin nazywa suwerenna demokracja.
Well, this is what Putin describes as sovereign democracy.
Co to znaczy dla Putina suwerenna demokracja? To znaczy, że ja, Putin, mogę zamykać do więzienia kogo chcę, zamykać go suwerennie i nikt w tym mi nie będzie przeszkadzał.
Well, what does sovereign democracy mean for Putin? That means simply I, me, Putin, can lock up anyone I want to in full sovereignty and nobody is going to bother me.
Ostatnio jest jeszcze gorzej, dlatego że on sobie przyznaje suwerenne prawo do interweniowania w innych państwach, do aneksji ich kawałków, jak to miało miejsce z Ukrainą i z Krymem. No.
Well, lately it went even further, even became even worse, because he assumed his sovereign right to interfere into the affairs of other countries and annex pieces of them, like it happened with Crimea and Ukraine.
No, i to się przypomina okres sowiecki. Był taki moment, kiedy chińskie wojska wkroczyły na teren Wietnamu.
Well, that resembles the Soviet era when the Chinese military entered the Vietnam.
W Moskwie ogłoszono, że to jest agresja.
Moscow declared it an aggression.
I wtedy myśmy w Polsce stworzyli nową definicję agresji.
It was at that time that in Poland we redefined aggression.
Co to jest agresja? Agresja jest wtedy, jeżeli jeden kraj napada na drugi kraj bez zgody Związku Sowieckiego.
Well, aggression is when one country attacks another country without the okay of the Soviet Union.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I think you may have answered my next five questions. but could I turn now to Consul General Kumin and ask him this question? The 1989 ended with the fall of the Berlin Wall, but the events that led up to that started, did they not, in Hungary? And perhaps I could ask you to describe those events, the picnic and other ones, and your own reaction to them and whether or not you thought they would have the result they did.
Thank you, John. And I would like to thank you all who organized this event, the Consul Generals of the three countries, to the Reagan Library. It's really wonderful to be here this morning. And I'm especially grateful for having high school students here. Probably what I can tell to you as my own experiences, because I couldn't really sell the story that I was really active in changing the regime. We wouldn't buy that because I was around 14 years old, and when I was born, Mr. Michnik was over his first imprisonment. So, and when he was imprisoned for the second time, I spent my primary school years, and my biggest problem was that I could only choose Russian as a foreign language to learn. So that was a different kind of problem, I guess, what I had to face in those years. But anyway, we even as kids, as young kids, as a teenager, could sense something, that something was really going to the wrong direction with our country, with our parents, with our lack of freedom, with our lack of choices in many cases. And that was not just the foreign language, the only one that we could learn, Russian, but the many other things, our lack of being able to travel, a lack of being able to apply for a phone line. Try to imagine today that we were not allowed as a family to have a phone line because we were not well connected in the Communist Party, and that's an understatement in our case, I guess. My experience was that my uncle, who had to leave the country in the 70s, couldn't travel home for the funeral of his father in the early 80s, because he was risking to be arrested by the Hungarian authorities because he left the country without permission, or he stayed too long in Switzerland, actually, there where he left. So those were the experiences of a young kid. But first, we could smell something changing in the mid of the 80s. Even from a young kid's perspective, the first signs of the free world approached our own apartments, schools. The TV set played an important role here. Those were the periods when we were able to see foreign TV channels for the first time. That was the second half of the 80s. And we realized that there's a world out there which is quite spectacularly different to the world that we have back home. There are more, seemingly there are more products out there to choose from, a much richer life, of course, bigger cars. And what there was a sense, probably I couldn't formulate it as a teenager, but it was clearly the sense of something that we were lacking the most. It's freedom, after all. Freedom to be choosing the leadership that we wanted. Freedom of an outside power, that the presence of that outside power was an everyday experience for us, walking on the streets of Budapest, Russian soldiers and their kids, actually, who were there, the families were there. They were around. They had a special school bus, so you could see that from a distance, that, okay, those are the Russian kids. So we could see that there is this pressure from a distant, closed room where decisions are made about our own fate, and these decisions are definitely not made by anyone in Hungary, and definitely not by the people I knew in my neighborhood, not by my parents, or not by anyone could have any influence of how Hungary is actually led and which direction the country goes. And that was the number one experience. And the other experience was when I started to ask questions to my parents, like, why is my uncle in Switzerland, and why couldn't he come home? And why are these Russian soldiers all around us? And they were like, oh my God, just keep silence, please. And as my parents' foreign language was German, not English, they were like, when they started to talk about politics, they realized that I can hear them. They were so afraid of that, probably I will talk about it in the school, that immediately they started to talk in German, and they were like, nicht vor dem Kind, which means not in front of the child. To stop immediately, because they risked my security, but their own security, their own safety as well, if I took something back in the school. So that was what surrounded us. And I can tell you very briefly that it was really like magic, because even the very small words that we could discuss in our family about the future and about what are the prospects of Hungary, none of my family members could really wish for a quick change in the system. Even around the end of the 80s, we could smell that something goes on. Little liberties appeared here and there, but every time we could sense that whenever they started to let us a little free, a little more distance to go, then they immediately stopped us there, not to allow to go too much further, both in economic terms and both in the terms of free speech and free discussion of our affairs. So when we suddenly experienced the change, that was really like magic, something that was unexpected, a beautiful revelation for all of those, I would say the majority of the Hungarians who were really waiting for such changes and to somehow experience what it's like to be free. And as a kid, and this is the last memory I want to share with you, I can recall when we had, at the end of this year, 89, the Romanian Revolution, which was the only in the region that wasn't without shooting a gun, and there was some bloodshed in that particular revolution, the Romanian, which is our neighbor country to the east, having lots of ethnic Hungarians in itself. And we were very much concerned about the things that were going on in Romania. And in our church, there was a spontaneous gathering of collecting clothes and all the medicines and all the materials that that the country in trouble could need. And I went there with my family, and we were packing the trucks that were going to Romania, and it was such an elevating feeling to be together there with all the volunteers. And, you know, for us, for Hungarians, to volunteer for a good cause that wasn't as common as for you guys here in the US, because you are free to volunteer for every good cause, but back in the communist era, you could be volunteer only for those things that were allowed to be volunteered. So that was something that we could feel, and even as a kid, a 14-year-old kid could feel that you can activate yourself for a good cause, and you can change the course of the history in a way. And that was really a fascinating experience for us.
Thank you very much. You were 14 in 1989. I was 14 in 1956. And I was one of the generation which was enormously impressed by the Hungarian Revolution and enormously depressed by its defeat. And I think that the huge and talented Hungarian diaspora meant that all over the Western world, people could not tell lies about communism of a glowing, optimistic, friendly kind if there was a Hungarian in the room. They would have to fall silent because the Hungarian's presence was a representative of a silent truth. Now, I'd like to turn to another event like that, which is the Prague Spring in Czechoslovakia, which was the next stage in the dissolution of the Soviet Empire, so to speak. It occurred in 1968, it was repressed, a very brutal form of normalization was imposed, and yet at the end it broke down. Was that because of what was happening outside, or was something major happening inside Czechoslovakia at the time that made the 1989 possible?
Well, first of all, it is funny that we, all three nations, organize the celebrations of the 25th anniversary of our own Berlin Walls. And it all started in Poland in June 89 with that first free election, of course, that it went through Hungary, and we were the last. Why was that? First of all, you have to see that even though the historic events were common and had much more higher causes, like when communism prevailed in our region, it actually was the result of the Second World War. And if you look at the line, how far the Red Army proceeded, it is basically more or less the area where communism was introduced by force and by coups, by other means. And in the same respect, obviously, if you look at it from today's perspective, it looks like clear that in the region, countries couldn't have survive as communist islands, as like some sort of North Koreas of the Central and Eastern Europe. Because in this region, things are more interconnected, and obviously this all began with, as John O'Sullivan very well wrote, with the election of Ronald Reagan, with the coming of Mrs. Thatcher, and of course with the election of Pope John II. And these were actually the beginnings of the crackdown of the communist rule over the region. So the 68, it was very much an isolated attempt to humanize the communist regime, as the 56 was in Hungary and 81 in Poland. In this respect, these were actually isolated attempts that weren't connected with each other. And most importantly, they didn't have this geopolitical environment so they could survive. With all due respect, America didn't do much when Hungarian Revolution was crushed so bloodily. In this respect, nothing much happened in the international arena when the Russian tanks crushed the Prague Spring, and the same nothing much happened in the world when there was martial law introduced after the 1981 Solidarność events in Poland. So all along these events didn't have the strength to change the situation on the ground, and they somehow ended in the defeat and in prevailing of the even more conservative communist forces. So in our country, again, I'm sort of trying to make this wide explanation why we were so late with our own revolution, because the 68 was such a recent memory, and because after 68, many of very able people emigrated, many of them to the United States, obviously, and many of them may even sit in this room as we speak now, and I welcome them, of course. But the point is that we were weakened, we were crushed, we were depressed, we were skeptical, and we never actually thought it was going to change in our lifetime. Even though we heard of the Polish events, we heard of the fall of the Berlin Wall, we saw on our TV that Hungarian government let the East Germans freely leave the country to West Germany via Austria. We saw all of that. Of course, RFE, the Radio Free Europe, John O'Sullivan was at one time at the helm of, actually stopped being jammed in 88, as late as in 88 in our country. But immediately we got this unfiltered news from all across the country. But itself, even that didn't help, that we would say, okay, they did it in Poland, they did it in Hungary, it's okay, it's a done deal. It was not. Each of the individual countries had to do its own revolution, and we were lucky we had Václav Havel, and that the rest is history.
Thank you. Perhaps I could just ask the three speakers, if they can, to keep their remarks, their answers reasonably short, because we really have another half hour of the discussion. But let me now turn back, if I could, to Adam Michnik and ask him this question. You were a leading member of Solidarity. That was originally a trade union movement. It became a great movement of national liberation. How was it that you and Ronald Reagan, Solidarity and Ronald Reagan, managed to establish such trust in each other, since on the surface you might think that a conservative, American conservative Republican wouldn't be the most natural ally of a Polish working class movement?
To mogło doprowadzić do tego, że była taka współpraca, że to byłem takim wspólnym wysiłkiem.
Tutaj trzeba chyba mówić o pewnym paradoksie. No.
We have to mention here a sort of a paradox.
Bo to był sojusz amerykańskiego konserwatysty z ruchem robotniczym.
The paradoxical thing was that it was a alliance of American conservatism with a workers' movement.
Solidarność miała wsparcie amerykańskich związków zawodowych.
The Solidarity, being a workers' union, had the support of the American trade unions.
I jak ja rozmawiałem z amerykańskimi związkowcami, to oni mówili tak. W Ameryce sytuacja jest straszna, bo my mamy do wyboru dwóch kandydatów na prezydenta.
When I spoke to the American trade unions representatives, they told me the following. The situation in America is just horrible. We have two different candidates for presidency between which we have to choose.
Jeden chce zniszczyć związki zawodowe, a drugi chce porozumieć się z Breżniewem, czyli chce zniszczyć cały świat. No.
One of them wants to destroy the trade unions, and the other one has to, would like to get in cahoots with Brezhnev, thus destroying the whole world.
W Polsce popularność Reagana była znacznie większa niż w Stanach Zjednoczonych.
Ronald Reagan was a lot more popular in Poland than in the United States.
Absolutnie, absolutnie. Do tego stopnia, że jak przyjechał do Warszawy Ted Kennedy, to myśmy go uprzedzali, żeby się nie zdziwił, jak będą na jego cześć entuzjastyczne okrzyki pozdrowienia dla Reagana.
Well, when Ted Kennedy visited Poland, we warned him, do not be surprised if you will be welcomed with yells, give our regards to Ronald Reagan.
Skąd się ta popularność brała? Ona się brała z pewnego języka, którym posługiwał się Reagan.
Where did the popularity come from? It came from the particular language that Reagan applied.
I kiedy intelektualiści amerykańscy czy europejscy mówili, że Reagan jest taki toporny, taki prymitywny, to my się mówi, właśnie taki jest potrzebny na Breżniewa.
Well, when the American intellectuals were describing Reagan as
European.
Rough, as European. Primitive,
brutalny taki.
And brutal, we were saying, yeah, that's somebody we need.
I rzeczywiście, jak on, jak Reagan powiedział, imperium zła, to myśmy w Polsce bili brawo, bo myśmy to tak odczuwali.
When Reagan called the Soviet Union the evil empire, we applauded because that's exactly how we felt in Poland.
Krótko mówiąc, Reagan podejmując konfrontację ideologiczną z Kremlem, nie mówił językiem dyplomacji, tylko mówił, przepraszam obecnych tu dyplomatów, językiem prawdy.
When Reagan talked to the Kremlin, he did not use a diplomatic language, and I have to apologize for the diplomats present here. He spoke the truth.
I co ciekawe, mianowicie, że nawet ludzie o orientacji liberalnej, niekonserwatywnej, popierali Reagana, bo to była nadzieja, że on da sobie radę z Breżniewem. No.
Even people of some liberal orientation supported Reagan because it was their hope that he will be able to handle Brezhnev.
Przecież w tym samym czasie, kiedy był wielki strajk w Wielkiej Brytanii, do Polski przyjeżdżała Margaret Thatcher i popierała związek zawodowy.
When during the general strike in Great Britain, Margaret Thatcher visited Poland and supported the trade unions.
Krótko mówiąc, najistotniejszy konflikt tamtego czasu to był konflikt między światem komunizmu i światem demokracji.
The most significant conflict of these years was the disagreement or conflict between communism and democracy.
I dlatego ja się cieszę, że dzisiaj znowu Ameryka w kontekście Rosji i Ukrainy mówi językiem prawdy.
This is why I'm happy today that today America, again, in the context of Russia and the Ukraine, speaks the language of truth.
W Europie to wygląda różnie.
In Europe, it's kind of like, eh.
Okay, that's a very good point at which to end that particular. Thank you. I'd like to, Fenwick, if I could tell you this story. Back in 1985, I was on the London Times, and the Foreign Office arranged for me to have lunch with an apparatchik from the Hungarian Communist Party. And a very interesting lunch, because he said to me, the hardliners are just about to suffer a defeat. They'll suffer a series of defeats at Central Committee meetings and so on. And by about 1989, 1990, we will have multi-party democracy. And this was, of course, I thought, an incredibly dramatic thing to be told. My question was, won't you lose the election? And he said, yes, we will the first one, but we'll win later ones. Everything you said turned out, to the surprise of me and my editor, to be correct. So what was it that persuaded the communists in Eastern and Central Europe, but in this occasion particularly the Hungarians, that the game was up? Within about 5 or 6 years of Ronald Reagan being in office, somehow or other, they were going to have to give up that particular kind of government and try to adapt to democracy.
Well, I was addressed as a diplomat to talk in truth terms, and not in diplomatic terms, so I try to do that, and I'm risking my career here with that. But, you know, I believe, you know, I represent my government, which is a conservative central-right government, and we have the firm standpoint that, after all, every leftish project ends up with running out or by running out the resources. No matter if it's in democracy or in a dictatorship, and this answers your question. Running up, totally running up for the resources, not just the resources that were available for the current generations back in the 80s, but even running out of the resources that were available for the upcoming generations, meaning indebting the country like hell. We were able to join the IMF earlier, before the change of regime, and we were able to be indebted really, really badly in those times. But even this was not enough to sustain an unsustainable economy, an unsustainable sort of a welfare that was around. So the communists in our country were really smart, and this caused a lot of trouble for us, obviously. It took us 20 years to really get rid of them, I can tell you. And as we sit here, I can bring you the good news that I guess we really achieved it and we really got rid of them. But unlike in Poland, unlike in the Czech Republic, unlike in other countries in our region, because they were so smart that the master plan was there, it was ready back in 85 to be presented to a British journalist. And it really was fulfilled as it was described back then. It was a wise plan. Everything was set into the right place. And this was the result, I guess, of a very, very well-organized communist leadership in our country that was very much open to the outside world. I have to admit this. To their credit, they really understood the world. They really understood what it meant to be running out of the resources, what it takes to save their power, to somehow transform their political power into economic and other symbolic powers. And for those who were who arrived from the anti-communist direction, it was really difficult to challenge such a well-organized, such a well-endowed community of professionals, because that's what they were. They were the power professionals, the politics professionals, and everyone who came to challenge them, they had no other choice but to be amateurs, because they couldn't really learn that school, couldn't really learn that language, couldn't really learn how to deal with governance, how to deal with other public issues, how to talk to people. I mean, there were some gifted people, of course. We have our own heroes, and I was lucky to work with some of them, like László Sólyom, who was the first head of our constitutional court, or the prime minister of today, Viktor Orban, who was also around by the round table talks, by the negotiations to bring down the communist regime. And he's still around in our politics, because he was a very, very young man when the change of regime was around. So I guess we were lucky to have talented guys from all walks of life who were able to manage the other side of the changes as well. But on the other side, the communist side, the establishment side, we had these very, very intelligent, open-minded people who were able to sustain their power for another almost 20 years, I can tell you, with certain, you know, alternations in the power, but they were always around.
I think it was Margaret Thatcher who made one of your points there when she said that the problem for socialists is that they keep running out of other people's money.
That's exactly.
But I'd like to turn, if I could, to Vaclav Havel. He was a major figure in a major moral leader under communism, and then, of course, a successful democratic politician. It seems to me that each of the countries produced leaders who were somewhat different from each other, all of them democratic, all of them lovers of liberty, but nonetheless quite distinct nationally. What would you say that Vaclav Havel, and maybe Vaclav Klaus as well, because the two Vaclavs really dominated the politics since 1989, what was distinctive about them that made them different and more or less effective than the political leaders of the other Central European and Eastern European countries?
Well, too humbled to speak of Vaclav Havel, of course, as he became not only, of course, our first democratically elected president, the leader of the revolution, but also the world-renowned figure. By the way, on November 19, the House will acknowledge Václav Havel's role by installing the bust to the Freedom Foyer. We will have a big celebration then on the occasion, of course, of this 25th anniversary. So thanks to the members of the House who voted in favor of, actually they were all, it was an unanimous resolution. So thanks to those who voted for this resolution, Václav Havel will have a bust in the Capitol. Well, Václav Havel was a philosopher, a playwright, but not too many people know that he was a very able organizer and a manager. In fact, he was able to organizing the first demonstrations in Prague as almost theatrical pieces, where he brought all sorts of peoples from different walks of life, dissidents, workers, noun artists, and whoever. And people really saw it and in fact felt included. This was his instinct, to include everybody. He knew that the society was so fractured and there wasn't almost any civil life in those years as the result of the normalization after the 68, so he needed to be inclusive. So this is why he created this civic forum, and he came with this slogan, we are not going to be as we're not going to do to you as you did to us. And so that he's in this, he succeeded in including even those who somehow participated in the regime, but they had this feeling that it was like a big line, and we would discontinue ourselves from the past. Václav Klaus, with his political vision, was then a rather divisive person. Let's say that. He came at the time when no longer it was necessary to unite, to embrace everybody, but he clearly knew that there was the time to decide which way are we going to go. Are we going to privatize quickly? Are we going to introduce the market economy quickly? Are we going to overhaul our welfare system? Or do we stumble and keep discussing and whatever else? So Václav Klaus credit goes goes to him for actually establishing a regular system of political parties, a political arena where people do not necessarily agree with each other. They rather disagree. And he actually was the first to teach us that it is totally okay to disagree with each other on things like privatization or the future of the welfare system. So while Václav Havel was a uniter, and he was able to give us those transcendent feeling and ideas of democracy, of humanism, of some higher meaning, Václav Klaus brought to us a regular democratic political system where things need to be decided in a democratic way and then done.
Well, thank you. That's a very that leads on to my next question. I should say that in 10 minutes' time, we're throwing open the questions to the floor. So I think it's probably prudent of me to suggest this is the last question that's coming from me. So I'm going to ask this question, which has already partly been answered by Adam Michnik, but I think he'll want to say more, and that is, has the promise of 1989 been fulfilled in Europe, in throughout Europe, not simply in East and Central Europe? And secondly, if it has been fulfilled or not domestically, what needs to be done and what needs in particular to be done to protect the status quo established in 1989 from the revisionist intentions of the Russian government?
Nigdy w historii żadna rewolucja nie spełniła wszystkich swoich obietnic.
Never in history, no revolution has fulfilled all its promises.
I ja to zawsze wiedziałem jako historyk, ale jako uczestnik tych wydarzeń świadomie chciałem zapomnieć o tym.
I was aware of it. I knew it as a historian, although as a participant of these events, I wanted to forget about it.
Tutaj trzeba się trochę cofnąć. Mianowicie postsowieckiej interwencji w Czechosłowacji nastąpiła tak zwana normalizacja.
We need to go back a bit here. After the Soviet intervention in Europe, in Czechoslovakia, a period of what is described as normalization began.
I to był okres okropnego łamania kręgosłupów, łamania sumień, szantażu, takiego upodlenia społeczeństwa.
It was a period of backbreaking, of destroying of souls and consciousnesses of people, and in general, it was a process, a period of
denigration,
destruction.
I z tego czasu pochodzi taki żart, że na głównym placu w Pradze stoi człowiek i wymiotuje żyga do fontanny.
There is a anecdote, a joke stemming from that era. There was a guy standing in the middle of Prague and barfing into a fountain.
Do niego podchodzi drugi i mówi tak, proszę pana, pan mnie nie zna, ale chcę panu powiedzieć, że się z panem całkowicie zgadzam.
Another guy approaches him and says, sir, excuse me, you don't know me, but I've got to tell you, I totally agree with you.
Mnie chodzi o to, żeby ten cały kontekst mieć w pamięci, kiedy się mówi o 89 roku. Że 89 rok to był taki rok, kiedy się prostowały karki ludziom.
We need to remember that 1989, at least the way I feel about it, was a year when people's back began to straighten up, when people began to become humans again.
Ale to często byli ludzie sfrustrowani, którzy wiele lat przeżyli w klimacie strachu, terroru i tak dalej.
Well, these people were quite often frustrated, people that lived for a long time in terror, in the climate of terror, and that was kind of their reaction.
Zawsze w naszych krajach, ja to słyszałem i w Pradze, i w Bratysławie, i w Budapeszcie, i w Warszawie, wszędzie, jest taka atmosfera zawodu, że właściwie rządzą nami łobuzy i złodzieje. No.
Well, I've heard that in Prague, in Bratislav, in Warsaw, everywhere, as a reflection upon the promises made in 1989, what we have today is we're being governed by hoods, hooligans, crooks. That's the general opinion.
Ja należę do tak zwanych optymistów, więc kiedy ja widzę tą szklankę z wodą do połowy pełną, to ja mówię, ona jest do połowy pełna, a pesymista powie, że ona jest do połowy pusta.
I'm an optimist. When I see glass half full of water, I say it is half full of water. A pessimist would say that it's half empty.
Więc ja spodziewałem się, że będzie gorzej.
I expected it's going to be worse.
Więc ja jestem pozytywnie zaskoczony.
So I am pleasantly surprised.
To nie znaczy, że wszystko jest w porządku, oczywiście.
It doesn't, of course, mean that everything is just hunky-dory.
Zasadniczo rzecz biorąc, 89 rok pozwolił na to, że Europa odzyskała drugie płuco.
Basically, my perception is that 1989 allowed Europe to regain its second lung.
Ale naturalnie wolność jest dla wszystkich, dla mądrych i szlachetnych, i dla głupich i podłych, dla wszystkich.
Well, of course, freedom is for everybody, for the smart and the noble and the stupid and the nasty guys as well.
I wartość demokracji dzisiaj w całej Europie polega na tym, że udało się uniknąć scenariusza bałkańskiego. Na Bałkanach wolność przyniosła wojnę.
The value of European freedom is such, or European 89 is such that we were successful in regaining freedom as compared to the Balkans, where freedom brought war.
W centrum Europy zwyciężyła wtedy ta inicjatywa wyszehradzka, Wyszehradu. I wydaje się, że przez te 20 parę lat ona odgrywała pozytywną rolę.
In the context of time, it seems that in Central Europe, the Visegrad initiative won. And in the context of time, it brought up the better values.
Te pęknięcia następują teraz.
The cracks are appearing now.
Dlatego, że w tej części Europy spotykają się dwie różne oceny sytuacji w Rosji na Ukrainie.
Well, because in that part of Europe met two different evaluations of the situation in Russia, Ukraine.
Więc z jednej strony jest stanowisko państw bałtyckich i Polski, z drugiej strony stanowisko też wewnętrznie zróżnicowane, stanowisko Bratysławy, Pragi i Budapesztu.
On one side we have the position of the Baltic states and Poland, and on the other side we have a slightly different approach in evaluation by the states in Prague, Bratislava.
Niemniej jednak to są normalne problemy demokratycznych krajów.
Nevertheless, these are normal day-to-day issues of democratic countries.
My w naszych krajach mamy poczucie, że to, co się zmieniło na lepsze, to jest naszą zasługą, a to, co się nie zmieniło, czy zmieniło się na gorsze, jest naszą winą, a nie Kremla. No.
Well, it is our feeling that whatever change for the better, it is thanks to us. Whatever change for the worst, it's our fault. Neither of it is done by Kreml.
Natomiast rolę Kremla trzeba od nowa przemyśleć w Europie.
However, the role of Kremlin in Europe needs to be reanalyzed once again.
Tam z sobą się spierają jakby dwie interpretacje. Jedna, która mówi, że sytuacja obecna przypomina sytuację sprzed pierwszej wojny światowej.
There are two different interpretations at the Kremlin. One faction says that the current situation resembles the situation before World War I.
Że wtedy dyplomatów zastąpili generałowie i dlatego do wojny doszło.
Well, before World War I, when it happened, diplomats were replaced by generals, and as a result, we had the war.
A druga interpretacja jest taka, że to przypomina sytuację sprzed II wojny światowy.
Well, the other group interprets this as the situation being resembling this, the situation before World War II.
Wydawało się, że Hitlera można ugłaskać.
It appeared that Hitler could be placated.
Że jak mu się pozwoli zmilitaryzować Nadrenię, że jak mu się pozwoli na Anschluss, jak mu się odda Czechosłowację, to on poprzestanie na tym.
Well, he probably could be happy by militarizing Rhineland, by the Anschluss of Austria, by just giving him Czechoslovakia. That should make him happy.
Otóż nie. Hitler miał apetyt jak rekin. On za każdym razem wygłaszał piękne przemówienia o pokoju i zagarniał kolejne kraje.
Well, it didn't work out that way. His appetite was like the one of a shark. Every time he would have a peace promoting speech and then he would gobble up another piece of the world.
Otóż Putin stosuje retoryczną technikę Hitlera.
Putin applies the rhetorical technique of Hitler.
I są znowu głosy, że to właściwie wszystkiemu winien jest Zachód, bo mu nie ustąpił w swoim czasie i to Putina zdenerwowało, że właściwie Krym to była Rosja. O co tu skandal robić?
Well, there are some voices that Putin was upset by the fact that the West did not yield, that you know, it upset him, and actually Crimea was always Russia, and so what's the big deal?
Jest to najpoważniejsze wyzwanie od 25 lat.
This is the biggest challenge since the 25 years that passed.
Thank you very much. Now that was a very rich answer. That was a very rich answer, and the audience obviously doesn't mind that we're cutting into its own question time, but I'm going to have to ask Mr. Gumin and Mr. Gandilovich to be fairly short in your reply.
Well, to me, the promise of the change of regime in our countries is the power that we are able to sustain the right to disagree. That's very important. The Hungarians wanted to disagree. Wanted to disagree in 56, back in 1956. That was the famous Hungarian Revolution. Well, they tried to disagree, but they couldn't because there was an outside force. The Soviet tanks came and the Soviet troops came into Hungary and they stopped the Hungarians, those who wanted to disagree. So this permanent will of being able to disagree, it prevailed in the Hungarians. And this is how we really, in our everyday life, how we feel that we are free. That no matter how or what is that actual mainstream idea politics, we should keep the right for us to disagree and tell our own version of it if there's support. And no one from the outside world can come, neither with tanks and troops or with, I don't know, strong persuasive power to say that you are all wrong. And this is what you have to think about the world. And this is how the Hungarians still perceive and still, you know, live up to their freedom, to always permanently have this right to disagree and choose their own way without any outside force that could, you know, change our track in this regard. And this is what is still a challenge. Because I guess that even though we don't have to talk about military aggression these days, but there are other means of other powerful groups of idea and ideology wanted to and still wants us to think differently. Sometimes people come and say that the Hungarian voters are wrong. And I say here, especially in this hall, it's right to say, and I guess Ronald Reagan would agree with me, that in a democracy, in freedom, you know, the voters never can be wrong. That's where the nasty thing starts, when someone comes and say that you all are wrong, and here I am, I'm right, and I'm probably backed with a powerful guy who will help me to somehow force my willingness onto you. And I guess this is what we have to sustain. And we are, you know, I'm quite optimistic. I am optimistic, as well as Adam Isnik is optimistic, that we're on a good track in this respect. Of course, I agree with you that this is a great challenge for us, what happens in our right at our borders, because Hungary is also has a border with Ukraine. I hope we can manage it. There are a lot of conversation and a lot of open discourse is required here, I guess.
Thank you. Mr. Gandalovich.
I almost forgot what was the original question, but I guess that do we feel fulfilled, or do we think that the revolution of 1989 reached its goals? Yes, we do. In spite of all sorts of questions and problems and bumps on the road, we do. We are part of the Western civilization. We are part of NATO and the European Union. We share with all our allies all the concerns, being it Russia and its newly, I would say, even discovered role, because if we had this conversation a year ago, maybe even here in America, many people wouldn't have ever thought that these things were going to happen, such a quick succession of events. Being in Russia, being it the Islamic terrorist threat, and also more specifically for us in the European Union, we are very much discussing the future of the European Union, of this construction of the cooperation of 28 sovereign, still sovereign states. But these are problems that we really do share with our neighbors, with other NATO members, with our European Union members. That means that the events of 89 have actually fulfilled its goal. To what Adam Michnik said about this division, I would not like to leave it unanswered, with all due respect, Mr. Michnik, because I do not want to the audience to leave with the notion that this is going to there is going to become a new division line between the new member states of NATO and European Union. Here in America, you always say that there is talk the talk and there's walk the walk, and I would like to use this opportunity to say that we really fulfill all the obligations of the sanctioned regimes of the NATO plans that have been agreed in Wales. So if it comes to walk, we walk the walk. There may have been some questions, particularly regarding the effectiveness of the sanction regime, but these shouldn't be understood as any divisiveness between our countries. It is, as my colleague said, the perfect right to discuss, maybe to question things, but then when it comes to a decision, we both Hungary, the Czech Republic and Slovakia, that is not represented here, have done what was needed to be done.
Thank you very much. I'm afraid we've cut deeply into your question time, but we still have 10 minutes or more. So if we could, yes, there's a gentleman here who wants to ask a question. Sorry, there's a lady there, I couldn't see you. Yes, would you like to be given the microphone?
Okay. First of all, I want to say I just got back from a tour from Eastern Europe, and I found all three of your countries beautiful. I grew up in the military. My dad spent 30 years in the Marine Corps. When the Hungarian Revolution came, he packed his mount-out bag, and he was ordered to report. The military was ready to go, but it was the executive branch of the government that stopped it. I have noticed the gentleman from Poland quoting Hillary Clinton. I noticed the executive branch, all due respect to the congressman, has a tendency to go into these countries and say, our way is the right way. And as the gentleman from Hungary said, you have the right to say no. My question is, looking at these secretaries of state, do you say no, or do you allow them to bulldog in with the offer of money?
Could I ask if that question is addressed to any particular person on the panel?
Any of them that would like to answer. I love the country, in fact, your countries. In fact, I'm going back next October.
Well, I think it was to you that was addressed, well, Mr. Kuhn.
Thank you for the question. Yes, it's an absolutely valid question these days. And look, we have a very unique relationship, ours, Hungarians, with the United States these days. You have to know that in economic terms, there's tremendous amount of investment in Hungary, and all those investors are very happy with their investments, no matter if it's a financial investment or a direct investment. We have a very well-functioning military cooperation, and I can tell you that the U.S. Army is very much satisfied with how the Hungarian soldiers cooperate in very dangerous and remote areas of the world, Afghanistan, to mention one. Whereas there are some symbolic questions where we have our differences, which is, I guess, it's an absolutely right thing to have in a democracy, where you have one color government, we have a different color of government, and this is right to have these differences. What is not right, I believe, is if one power wants to push its own agenda onto another country, and especially it's not right when there are, you know, obvious differences in power and dimensions. So whatever we try to really focus on our friendship, which is really strong and roots back in these areas, the change of regime in the area of Ronald Reagan. But at the same time, we try to you know, reserve our right to express our set of values and to keep our own way, which is very much justified by a big percentage of the Hungarian voters. And I guess that is something that everyone should respect if someone is in favor of democracy. In favor of democracy without adjectives. So I always start to be cautious when someone puts adjectives. You mentioned sovereign democracy or liberal democracy or any kind of democracy. That always tries to exclude some guys from the group. So we believe that you know, there shouldn't be no one who would like to set that ours is the only game in town. And whenever someone tries to set that thing, tries to spread that idea that there could be only one game in the town, then we Hungarians start to be skeptical with those ideas and start to, you know, scrub our heads and say, okay, well, yes, that's nice, but let us disagree.
May I ask? There is very little time left. May I ask the questions to set the speakers an example of brevity, and may I ask the speakers to follow it? Where's the next question? Yes.
You mentioned your opinions on the current events in Russia and Putin. I was wondering if, as freedom fighters yourselves, some of you, what are your opinions on groups like ISIS who claim to be claim to be liberators but actually oppress their people.
By the way, is that addressed to any particular person on the panel?
Not particularly, but I guess Mr. Micknick, if I had to choose one.
give me a sec. Wyraziliście swoje opinie na temat Ukrainy. Co myślicie o ich freedom fighters, ich wolności? Co myślicie na temat ISIS, która twierdzi, że wyzwala ludzi, a jednocześnie to są okupanci? Pytanie, chciałbym, żeby wszyscy odpowiedzieli na to pytanie, ale szczególnie chciałbym, żeby Adam Michnik na to odpowiedział.
Tak. Ja oczywiście o ISIS myślę tak jak prymitywny europejski liberał, czyli myślę jak najgorzej.
Well, as far as ISIS is concerned, I think of it as a primitive European liberal, which means the worst.
Więc ja oczywiście zgadzam się z opinią mojego węgierskiego kolegi, że nikt nie może o sobie powiedzieć, że posiadł pełnię prawdy.
I naturally agree with the opinion of my Hungarian colleague that nobody can say about himself that he is the only one that knows and has the truth.
Natomiast jak ja słyszę w Polsce reakcje na krytyczne wobec polskiego rządu, opinie za granicą i te reakcje na krytycyzm odwołują się do tego, że my, Polacy, mamy prawo myśleć tak, jak chcemy, to ja wiem, że coś się niedobrego w moim kraju dzieje.
When I listen to critical reactions to the decisions and moves of the Polish government, and I listen to the reactions being expressed by Poles who are saying, we, the Poles, have the right to think what we think, then I know that something wrong is going on in Poland.
Dlatego, że ja przypuszczam, że to jest takie pojęcie suwerenności putinowskie właśnie.
Well, I think that this approach is kind of a Putin-like understanding of sovereignty.
Ono jest putinowskie, ono jest charakterystyczne dla ajatollahów w Iranie i też dla pewnych środowisk skrajnej prawicy nacjonalistyczno-katolickiej w Polsce.
It is typical for Putin, it's typical for the Ayatollahs, it's typical for some extremely right-wing Catholic groups in Poland.
Więc ja nie odczuwam nigdy wrażenia, że jakieś dzisiaj grupy z zewnątrz chcą Polsce coś narzucić. A kto mówi w ten sposób, to ja wiem, że jemu chodzi o coś, co jest nieczyste.
I understand that nobody from the outside who speaks like that wants to force upon Poland something that we don't want to or a different opinion. Although I feel that someone who speaks in that manner, there's something unclean about it.
Bo jeżeli on mi mówi, ty jesteś de facto reprezentantem obcego kapitału, czy obcych sił, to ja wiem, że jemu nie chodzi o obronę własnego stanowiska, tylko jemu chodzi o to, żeby mnie zdezawuować.
If somebody tells me You represent foreign capital. You represent foreign powers. It is clear to me that is not for him important to defend themselves, but to just belittle me.
No, to tam by było tyle słów Ewangelii Świętej na dzień dzisiejszy.
I think that would be it for the sermon for today.
Well, I think democracy we've heard earlier is the realm of disagreement, and this is a very democratic panel. But this is also the last question. Yes, the lady there.
Jeanette Dole, New York City. In 1979, the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan. Subsequent to that, the Muslim Haji fighters, with the help of the CIA, defeated the Soviet Union and they left. I would like to know what effect that had on Eastern Europe, on Poland, on Hungary, and the Czech Republic. Thank you.
If I could direct that question to Mr. Gandalovich, this has to be the last answer, I'm afraid.
Well, as I said, that the overall geopolitical environment enabled for our respective revolutions to succeed. Of course, the defeat of the Soviet Union in Afghanistan as a result of some brave decision made here in the United States was one of the part of the important, I wouldn't even say puzzle, but maybe let's say chain of events that led to this overall weakening of Soviet Union, the weakening of its grip, and eventually again enabling us to take our own fate in our own hands. So I do not wish to elaborate on to what extent the subsequent events led to what happened in Afghanistan in the 2000, and what is it now happening in Syria, where ISIL has actually emerged. The point is that sometimes it is easier to win a revolution rather than to build something new and sustain it. And that's, of course, as Rudyard Kipling would say, it's another story.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to say end as follows. In 1989, all the good guys were on the same side. Then they won power, and some turned out to be on the left, and some turned out to be on the right, and they were in the realm of democracy, that is, of disagreement and division. But the fact was, they were in the realm in which the most important democratic right exists today in Europe, and that is the right to throw the rascals out. Provided you have that, you ultimately have democracy. Now, having said that, I think we've had a very lively and indeed democratic panel, as I suggested. We've heard some wonderful reflections on our current discontents and contents. I want to agree with Adam Michnik that as someone who was more or less on his age at the time all these things happened, that things have turned out worse than we had hoped, but better than we had expected. and on those grounds, I'd like to turn now to John, because I think a presentation is about to be made.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, this is an original piece of the Iron Curtain. And let me allow to read this piece of Barbed Wire is a part of the Iron Curtain alongside the Hungarian-Austrian border that palpably represented the division of the European continent into two halves. Its dismantling was made possible by the will of the Hungarian people and the recognition of peaceful coexistence and mutual interdependence. We believe that the artificial, physical, and spiritual walls still existing in the world someday shall collapse everywhere.
Thank you very much. I'd like to join John in thanking our panel here. It was an incredibly enlightening discussion, and we are so honored to have all of you come. Thank you for traveling as far as you have to educate and entertain our terrific audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.